Hey guys, Leah from LeahForSci.com, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to use the Molecular Visions Model Kit for your organic chemistry class. The kit that I recommend is the Molecular Visions Organic Model Kit. There's the small one, which I'm holding right here, and then there's the large one. The two are basically the same. The larger kit has these extra, if you see these big circles, for atoms, I honestly think they're overkill. And for your organic chemistry class, you don't want to be spending a lot. Something like this has everything you need and is more than enough. And you can get this on Amazon. Just go to leahforsci.com/kit. That's my referral link, and I do get a small commission if you use that link. So let's break it open and see what we have here. That's if you don't actually cut into the bag, but at least we get it out of the bag. So you're going to have two things. One is this bag over here with all the pieces, and then you have the box for storing your kit. My advice is to get another bag because you probably won't be able to fit it back in here once you have some of the pieces built up, and you probably won't be able to get it back into the box either. So I just keep it in a bag. Mind you, I have many kits thrown together, so I have a very big bag. Even more challenging than the model kit itself is figuring out this box. So here we have the instruction book, which has some really impressive models, but we're not going to use that. For the fun part, the bottom of the box. That wasn't so painful. And here we go. All right, so here's the box, and this probably fits in your bag. Keep this at home though. If your professor allows a model kit on your exam, bring it along, but bring it in a bag with some pre-built structures. That way you don't have to waste your time. And I'm going to show you how to do those. So what do we have in this kit? We have these black sp3 pieces, and one itself is not going to be sp3, but when you connect it to a second one, they link up just like that. It's a little bit of muscle to connect that, to get that click in there. That right there would be considered your sp3 carbon. So we definitely need a lot of these, and we have a bunch of these. Then we have the same thing in red, gray, and blue. These are so that you can create either different substituents or if you want to make something stand out. Also, red typically refers to oxygen if you want to call it that way. I like to use different colors if I'm trying to emphasize a certain functional group. Then we have these, they kind of look black, but they're slightly gray and shiny. And these are the flexible ones. I use these when I'm demonstrating the hexagon before doing a chair conformation, because if I flatten out a hexagon with the sp3, they tend to be very weak and they start to fray over here. But using the flexible ones gives me a little bit more lifespan because I have broken a few of these already. Then we have these here, which is a pi bond that is pre-built, and that's if you want to attach a pi bond to a molecule. For example, if you consider this to be a carbon with a double bound oxygen, this could be formaldehyde. So that's your pre-built pi bond. But if you want to show that double bond between a carbon and an oxygen, typically the gray represents carbon to carbon, you might want to use the half pi, because then you have half of the gray and half of the red. And that right there would be a carbon to oxygen double bond. Then we have this right here to represent a triple bond, where that would be one carbon, that would be another carbon, and there's your triple bond. You have the Y plane and the Z plane for your two pi bonds, and then here you can just elongate the chain in either direction. And finally, we have the individual atoms. If we want to attach an atom to a structure, white is typically used for hydrogen, red for oxygen, and you could honestly do whatever you want with it, but it does help to have the four different colors. So now that we have the kit, what are the main structures that you're going to see in your organic chemistry course? Obviously, we have the sp3 carbon. So we want to build up a couple of these, and I recommend actually keeping a few of these pre-built so that you have them handy no matter what type of structure you're trying to create. Now that they're built up, let's see what we can do with this. But first, I want you to look for the link below that says do not rely on your organic chemistry model kit, because it's very easy for this to become a time-wasting crutch. And instead of helping you on exams, it's going to hurt you. It's going to waste your time. But it's a very useful tool for studying because you can look at structures on paper all day long, but when you're holding a model in your hand, when you're demonstrating a molecule or a concept in three dimensions, everything becomes so much easier. For example, here we have a 5-carbon chain pentane, and instead of looking at it as a line, notice that these 109.5 degree bond angles gives you that zigzag line structure. This is why skeletal structure is drawn in a zigzag. Sometimes it's difficult to confuse a 5-carbon chain in a row with something that maybe looks like this. These look like two different molecules, but no. This is the same exact structure. These are just conformational isomers because I am turning it, but they're the same exact molecule. To get familiar, just rotate these a few times and get really, really comfortable with what's going on. To add substituents, we just connect it wherever. Here we go. That's a substituent. The next topic where this comes in handy are Neumann projections. For Neumann projections, you're used to looking at the model down to specific carbons. For example, if we have something like ethane, which is 2 carbons bound together, and 3 hydrogens on each side for a total of 6. This would be our ethane molecule. And for the Neumann projection, we typically look down carbons 1 to 2. So holding your model kit, just turn it, and there you go. That is a beautiful Neumann projection. That right there is the eclipsed conformation. And if we rotate it slightly, we get the staggered conformation. But holding it in your hand, it's very easy to see what's going on. Maybe this doesn't fully demonstrate the power of the Neumann, so let's make it bigger. Here we can imagine butane. That's 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons. And if we want to look at a Neumann projection down to carbon 2 to 3, just rotate it. So carbon 2, the first black one, is the first one you see. And there's carbon number 3. Carbon 3 is hidden behind number 2, but here we have the substituents. Here we have the substituents. They are anti and staggered. Or we can make them eclipsed, and now look at that, the eclipse structure, they're starting to be very close together. And rotating this a few times will give you a true appreciation for the energy between staggered, eclipsed, anti-Gauss, and all that fun stuff. The next time you want to use your kit is for chair conformations. For a chair conformation, we need 6 carbons in a hexagon, and this is where that flexible piece comes in handy, because if I try to flatten it out to prove to you why the chair conformation is needed, notice that that is straining, and it almost wants to break. To make it stable and to make that true chair, make sure that you have every other one facing up or towards you when you're looking at it head on. So we have up, down, up, down, up, down. And from the side, it's much easier to see up, down, up, down, up, and down. And the chair concept is right here. So that would be where you lay your head. This is where you put your body. This is where you have your feet. And that's your chair. To understand the interactions on a chair conformation, simply add a bulky group, and there we go. Diaxial interactions, very easy to see. And of course, a ring flip. And now the diaxial interactions are gone, and this is so much more stable. This helps explain why equatorial is more stable than axial. To do that ring flip, up, down, everything just flipped, and we're back to diaxial. And last but not least, where everybody tends to rely on the kit is stereochemistry. For stereochemistry, the first thing you want to do is play around with your different color substituents to identify and prove to yourself that when you have chiral carbons, enantiomers are not superimposable. This is where I love having the different color groups, and this is why I like this kind of kit. It's so easy to build and work with, but it's very obvious what is going on. If we have enantiomers, there would be a mirror between them. If they're superimposable, then they wouldn't be enantiomers. In this case, I happen to have built two of the same thing. Look at how they perfectly line up with each other. Every color matches up with every color. To turn this into an enantiomer, we do one swap, because remember, an odd number of swaps gives us the enantiomer. Now, if I try to superimpose it, if I line up the blue and the green, the red and the white are backwards. If I try to make the red and white line up, the blue and the green are backwards. So these are not superimposable because they're mirror images. And if I put them side by side, you can see they are mirror images. You can take this a step further when looking at multiple chiral centers. To differentiate the two groups, put something different on it. For example, a red bulkier group. And here we go, same thing. We have two molecules that look very close together. Chiral carbon, chiral carbon. The upper carbons are mirror images of each other. The lower ones are identical. This would be considered a diastereomer. And if you play with it, you'll notice that if I try to, for example, rotate and make the lower carbon colors line up, this red group is in the opposite direction and so on. So just play around with this a little. And one more thing that I shouldn't forget is a Fischer projection. So a Fischer projection would be, for example, looking at something like this. Once you build it, you can say, that's my Fischer. These come out towards you like the bow tie. These are going back like the spine. It's fading away. And then you just draw it exactly like this as a Fischer projection. The last thing I want to look at is, now that you know how to use the kit and you've practiced with it and you're comfortable with it, what do you do going into an exam? If you have this kit, here is what I recommend doing prior to your exam. Build up the structures that you think you might need. That means build up two chiral carbons with a unique substituents already on them so that if you have to pull this out in an exam, you're ready to go. Build up six more of these in case you have to do a chair. All you have to do is add two more. What about the rest of the chair? Build up something like this, because this way you have another group ready. In case you have to build a chiral molecule with more than just one carbon, you can easily pull off one of these, attach them here. That gives you a bigger chiral molecule, and you have the second one ready to go for comparison. Or if you have to do a chair conformation, you can easily attach these two right here, and you have your chair ready to go with substituents. And of course, if you don't need the chair, you also have this ready as a potential Neumann projection with four carbons and any unique substituents you need to place on it. Doing this in advance will A, give you the confidence to know that if you do need to pull out your model kit, you're not scrambling to try to build up the structures based on the exam, but you have the building blocks ready to go and you just have to connect them together. And B, knowing that you have it will make you confident, but hopefully you're learning the shortcuts and tricks that I teach in my other videos so that you don't even need your model kit, but you have it there for safety just in case you do. And if you notice, this will never fit back in this bag, and it certainly is not fitting back in here. Not if you plan to close it anyway. So just put it into a bag. Bring these along in a smaller bag, maybe even the initial bag. But this right here, this is going to save you time on the exam, so have this ready to go. And of course, if you like this video, first make sure to give it a thumbs up. Second, subscribe. And third, let me know in the comments which organic chemistry topics you're working on right now and what kind of videos you want to see coming to my channel in the future. For in-depth video series on all the topics we discussed using the model kit today, from isomers to Neumann projections, chair conformations, stereochemistry, Fischer projections, and so much more, visit my website for the Organic Chemistry Syllabus Companion, because this will allow you to compare your syllabus to my list of videos and make sure you quickly find what you want. My YouTube videos are short and to the point, but for even more in-depth tutorials, including very detailed workshops with lots of practice, shortcuts, tips, tricks, and more, come join me in the Organic Chemistry Study Hall, which will be your new tutoring replacement at a fraction of the cost. Full details on my website, leahforsci.com/join.